Ja,
Let me just thank the panelists for a really interesting and thought-provoking presentations and comments. I'll try to be short. Let us first look at, first the question was here, building a capable state. Capable for doing what, which we haven't asked. And it obviously is serving their community, their various communities. So it's, and then we must ask ourselves, and it comes came out in all the presentations, what are the factors that militates against the capable state of emerging in order to serve their respective communities of each local government? And I'll identify a number of factors that have been sometimes directly mentioned, otherwise sometimes indirectly. The first factor, I would say, is political instability. We are in a remarkable time where there is real political contestation. That in itself is great. It is a vigorous democracy. But what we've seen is very unstable municipalities where the contest is very narrow. And we see our three major metros teetering the whole time on whether it's minority government, whether it's a minority of plus one. Obviously, it's not great. The second point about this new political vigor is that the depths of divisions are getting deeper and deeper. It is not as if there is a sense of cooperation. I have the privilege or misfortune of reading through the dockets of all the interventions that the Western Cape has gone through. And the inability of the council to pass a budget, they level. And no one would give an inch. And the date for the budget would simply pass. Because the DA and the ANC would not ever concede anything to give. So, and that, I think, is great. Then, obviously, it also then goes with the depth of this political contest is the ability to do cadre appointments. And it cuts to both sides, whoever it is, controls the state, controls appointment. So political instability, and for lack of a better word, is a clear problem of building the capable state, because if cadre employment, as Pandile was telling us, is the norm, then we have a great difficulty with building the capable state. Now, the politics, the political instability must be read within a very strong trend of the patrimonial state, the emergence of this. And Yard was just, his concluding remarks was that now everything is possible, any conceivable that corruption is in fact, or the misuse of the state, not for a service, but as serving one, the politicians, and two, serving the institution itself. We have a political class which in the end is very much serving their own interests. And it's been documented widely. Ministers complain about the whole state serving itself, self-service as opposed to community service. We see the again in these contexts, in these troubled municipalities, the fight in between the parties about who will be mayor, who will be speaker, are so vicious. In the end, they become a stratagem used to keep in power, and the local parties who are totally up for sale for anything. expresses a notion that this is money that we would not forgo. In case it end, you die, or people get by now. So it's seen the state as something that serves a particular class, or sometimes even a particular political party. Now, the professionals, which are much vaunted as to be the capable state, are as professional to be unprofessional that they are very able to circumvent rules. So then the same, having a professional there, does not mean the end of corruption. It may do so. Now, you have then to place this patrimonial state also within the third factor, which I call the declining, is that we've last year went into recession. We are slowly getting out of 1%, now it's 1.2%, but the whole time you must remember this is below the population growth. So we're not growing yet, even with 1.2, 1.5, I don't know. Tragedy, what's the prediction now? Yeah. It's below the population growth, so we're not growing. And we've seen the austerity budget coming through, that first, budgets of municipalities are less, they're getting less money on infrastructure development. So we are in that one. And the further manifestation of this is the fact that municipalities are bankrupt. They talk about, and I think Derek, you made this interesting comparison the other day, about municipalities who are dysfunctional are not the same as 60 or odd ones that can't pay ESCOM. So whatever Dukok may use to describe dysfunctionality, I don't think it is very relevant. But it is, are they being able to pay the basic supplies, ESCOM and the water boards, not even to say about all the other service providers. So, and that clearly is a reflection in part of the consistent economic recession or stagnation of growth, which boils down, people don't pay their accounts, can't pay their accounts, and so municipalities, also part of corruption or bad management, can't pay their major suppliers. ESCOM, which itself has to increase its prices because of its own corrupt activities. So it's a vicious circle that combines with it. Then the fourth factor, if you take all these things together, that compounds it, is then failure at the top. We had the stories about the Department of Water and Sanitation, which are now openly recognized as having failed, being so many billions in debt. Now, I don't know what the figure is. It's massive. And just the figures that Ian was telling us about the number of instability there at the top. No engineers, MISA. It runs through. Bizarre thing, and just Jaap told me this morning about planning is now on the Department of Trade and Industry. Yeah. So, it's difficult to get one's mind around how come that government, in its infinite wisdom, places it in the department has never dealt with. With local government. So, even if we talk to the National Treasury, it is the star department. It was nearly captured, it will be captured for a bit, and some of the institutions were captured. But the implementation of one program to get capability and professionalism in local government in terms of people capable capable and trained professionals as CFOs and as municipal managers are since Prandile 2007. This is now 12 years later, and I don't think the program is even fully implemented. We talk about an incapable state at the national level, not being able to do the most basic intervention of getting capable people in municipalities, even that right, then you have difficulties. But not to blame everything to the top, is the fourth factor is, I think, that this disjuncture between local government and their communities. And there's a number of communities. The community, we see it in protests, we see it in a political class living for itself, and that they are not connecting with the community and springing up of localized political parties, maybe an example of that. Now, these are the factors I would then say militate against the emergence of a capable state, capable of delivering services or serving the communities that they must do so. So, the question would be, and I think, Derek, you asked that very pertinent question of some of the panelists, was how do you get out of this position that we are in? And I'm not talking about time frames here, I'm talking about just measures, and I'll come to time frames right at the end. The first one is, how do you move out of political instability? And the viciousness of the political divisions that there are now. I think practically, one should really think about reintroducing the executive committee system, where you form your executive no longer a winner takes all, but an inclusive politics. Inclusive that all political parties to a certain strength would be represented in the executive committee. And the notion that you would then soften your divisions. Trying to move away from the idea that you could have deadlock about a budget, but who's a mayor? In KZN, they had to dissolve councils because they simply could not choose a mayor or a speaker. I think they started with the speaker. So the notion is that you would be able to start building much more on a consensus basis. The government of municipalities. And we've done it in the past. It happens still in KZN, and there's no reason why it cannot be much more widespread across the country. Then, of course, getting politics right and cooperative politics right is difficult enough, but then there must be a limitation, obviously, of politicians themselves. And I think Bendile has spelled out, if we want to go professionalize, good professionalizing the administration, they must be able to use the profession knowledge. Doesn't help if there is no clear separation between political decisions and technical, practical decisions. Now, the second problem was then the patrimonial state. We were in dire circumstances 6 months ago. What would happen in the ANC? Would there be continuation of a particular epoch? Now we've got Ramaphosa, the euphoria of having a new leader. Will that in fact be able to move decisively in order to deal with leadership from the top about how to deal with corruption, which permeates throughout the state, through the provinces, three municipalities. That is going to be critical. But I'll come back to you later. It cannot be dependent upon the top to set the tone. It has to come from the bottom as well. So the tackle of the patrimonial state is probably one of the biggest issues that we will have to face as a country, and it will have to be faced at local government as well. Changing leadership will be fine, but it's a long process. All the politicians that I've spoken to says this is 3 years project of just minimizing, weeding out the corruption that has emerged. The more difficult is then the third problem of the declining economy. And there's no clear answers. There's no clear vision from government yet. Where is the political will and the direction to get us out of a system of stagnation, economic stagnation, to one that grows? Everyone says the future lies through education. How is it possible that we have at this stage 78% of our learners in grade 4 can't read for meters? And it's consistent. Is there no political will in order to change the education system? It's the biggest budget expenditure item. The results are remarkably weak. So, the real difficulty is then how do you start growing, what are the short-term and long-term ways, and there I think we have very little leadership or notion of where we're going at. The same will happen now at local government level with the money that they have, how they're going to spend it. They, as we heard from Ashendra, cities particularly are going to be the drivers of economy, various nice schemes of corridor, integrated corridors, etc. But at the same time, trying to make cities attractive for investment, of economic growth, how do they must deal with poverty at the same time, and how is that balance to be struck? That is going to be highly difficult. How do you stop failure at the top? Third, the fourth factor. Competitive politics is the only answer, either within a party, and that is within the ANC, and between parties. And we see now already movements in party politics as competition heats up, shifts to the left on land, shifts to the right in terms of economics. So there is no other way I can see to get better, more accountable system of proper leadership and governance at the top. But I think one should be warned against not relying on salvation shall come from up high. And there is local initiative, I think, a key one. Everything that Jacques mentioned, the notions of innovation, the gaps in innovation, how the linkages with the community happens. And I think the wonderful example that you mentioned, Jacques, about this fancy high skyscraper, and suddenly must have 20% of social housing. Yeah? Everyone thought building social housing is up there, somewhere far in the periphery, and had to be solved by transport. Now you see it in the center of the city. And clearly, I think British Deville was playing politics, but for the good. This is competitive politics. And now you have a whole new way of looking at buildings in the city centre. But that is local innovation. So it's linkages between the community and here with the private sector, building. And that you're not sort of falling in this path dependency story that we are just what we are made by from Victoria, but the ability to innovate, to try new ideas, to experiment. And so I see that a lot of attention has been given about how do you encourage this local innovation, which again, I think, is driven by competitive politics. Finally, on just a question of time frames, Derek, I think time frames are dependent on political will and the will to overcome vested interests. We had this remarkable change in the first couple of years, and we changed the face of local government within 7 years, from 1993 to 2000. Remarkable. But there was the will, and all other things were swept aside. Now we can't even change a small thing of re-looking at district municipalities. It took us now, how many years now, since 17 years probably more. And there's no movement. So the political will is not there. So I think it's a function, whether you want to mobilize forces, how strong is the vested interest, and if there's a real interest, it's a short horizon, if there's very little, we have a long horizon, till that will eventually materialize.
Thanks, Mac.